All right, I'm gonna shoot one of these videos about some of the things that I learned this year as we're kind of coming to, I got a little bit late, but we're still in the very last day of 2019. And I'm gonna kind of go through the months of the year and just some of the different things that I learned, and then also like what are some of the highlights, and then also just some general things that I kind of had epiphanies on this year. So, you know, January was interesting because towards the end of 2018, my wife and I sat down and our company was doing better than it had ever done in the history of it from a financial perspective. You know, we've always been able to grow revenue, but sometimes when you're growing revenue, like, are you always able to become as profitable as you would want? And, you know, that took us in 2017, that wasn't the case. And towards the end of 2018, we really figured that out, like how to actually generate profit from the business on a percentage and a dollar basis. And so we sat down in late 2018 and we realized, oh my gosh, you know, like if we spent another $100,000 a month on payroll for other team members to come on the team, is it really possible that we wouldn't make more on the business because the business was doing very well? And, you know, I think sometimes you look back and you realize you make decisions in sort of more of an emotional way than sort of an analytical way. And that was definitely not the best sort of way to think about it, because I can tell you, if you hire an extra $100,000 a month of employees, that's an extra $1.2 million a year, it is possible that you will not make more money. And so in January this year, that kind of all came to a head because Q4 of 2018, we sort of ramped up our hiring. We hired almost an extra $100,000 a month of team members. And, you know, we realized that the way that we were scaling the team was not well thought out. And so we realized that it just did not make a lot of sense in that January. And, you know, we had had a department already and we were just adding people to it, but the way that we were scaling it didn't make sense. And so we had an increase in cost, but actually sales went down because it created all this sort of inefficiency in the process. And so in January, we had an event, which went really great. We did a CFO bootcamp, Chief Financial Officer Financial Coaching Bootcamp. We had like 150 people there. And, you know, another one of my failures in January was we had that event and there was like 150 people. And I've always been very good at selling like one-to-one. So you get on a phone call, you know, you do a sales consultation with somebody, but I never really knew how to do selling on a stage. But so when I was in January, I went on stage and, you know, I offer everybody one of our programs, and only one person had signed up, 150 people in the room. And it's so embarrassing. One day I'll share the video. So embarrassing how I did the pitch and everything. Had one person sign up and then they backed out, right? Literally have 150 people. And I saw that problem later in the year, and I'll tell you a little bit about that in a second. But so in January, I'm like, oh my gosh, like we had this thing. Now people paid to be the event. So the company made money on the event, but like when you get that many people in a room, you want to use it as an opportunity to offer them something else, give them another experience, give them something else to do with you. So I totally messed that up. In February, I went to on a, so in January, I realized that, you know, hiring all these people didn't make as much sense. And also realized that, oh my gosh, how did I not like sell more people at this event? We were up to like, I think we had people running overnight shifts to finish the textbooks that we gave out there. We gave out 1200 pages of textbooks, but it just did not make sense. So that was January. And, you know, I also, every year in January for the last like 2 or 3 years, I've always like tried to go crazy in January, and then I never end up doing that well, because I like take all these risks. I'm like, oh, start the new year, right? And, you know, then we end up kind of having to backtrack. So, you know, this year I actually made a more of an effort for 2020 to sort of have a more of a concerted, like sort of measured start, and see how that goes. Because for the last, I think, 3 years, I've tried to go, or 2 years, I've tried to go crazy in January, and both times it's been a little bit setback. Because it's like, what's the point and purpose in January in particular? Yes, it's the beginning of the year. Yes, people feel a certain way, but does it need to be the time that you go crazy? I think that, you know, you forget how long the year is and how many opportunities you have to make things work. So this year we're gonna take a little bit easier. So I realized that hiring an extra 100,000 a month of team members doesn't necessarily work. I also realized that I did not know how to sell on stage. And I realized that, you know, really, I don't need to try to go crazy in that January. And so that was a couple of big takeaways. In February was when I really started to understand, like, okay, like the number of people we had on the team did not make sense. I think we had up to like almost 50 full-time team members. And this was the first time we really had to do layoffs this year. I mean, we, you know, I would say I've done probably layoffs in my company probably like 3 times. Where there was a lot of, you know, people that had to be let go as a percentage of the team. But like they might have been contractors in the past. Like, I think at one point we had five contractors that we let go. And so, you know, but this was the first time we really actually had to do layoffs. And we actually had 22 people in one day that we had to let go. And we had built out this whole division of our, mostly sales related. So like this whole, and I built it based on like a mentor that I was working with. And it was basically people that were setting appointments. But when they were doing that, like, it was a combination of problems. Like, we didn't train them. We didn't have a good process. We were sort of building it after the, over this guy that had a different kind of business than ours. And so, you know, it was a terrible situation. Luckily, most of these people did not have, they were kind of coming in. This is another problem too. When we hired that many people, when you're hiring that many people that quickly, you're generally not looking for people that already are in a job, that are, you know, so you're not looking for like people that have experience, have been in this, are doing this currently. You're just looking for people that are available, especially in the economy right now. There's, you know, close to full employment. Like, so we didn't have the best team members. And so we didn't have the best team members, didn't have the best process. We let 22 people go in one day in February. And so that was a really interesting sort of, you know, seeing that Q4 ramp up of team members and seeing that not work out, January kind of realizing it, and then February saying, oh my gosh, this really does not make sense. So that was a huge moment. And then in March, I had always been wanting to join this particular, I think this was in March, I've always been wanting to join this particular group, and it's like a mastermind group. And I applied for it in like 2017, I think, and I never got in. And so then I ended up going working with this other guy. And I was like, you know, I've got to get into this thing. Like, this is crazy, right? I've got to get into this thing. And so I basically wrote a letter. It's like a one-page letter. And I put a check in there for $50,000. And I sent it to the CEO of this company. And I said, dude, like, I can't wait for this anymore. Like, I want to get in. I want to meet some of the people that are in this group. And funny enough, he didn't even call me back, even when I sent him a check for $50,000. And so I ended up having to get in touch with his VP of marketing. And she had like a little program that she was running on the side. So I joined her little program. And I said, I'll join your little program. But the one thing I want to make sure is that I can get into this group, right? So she's like, no, I can do that. I can get you into this group. And so she called the CEO, and they called me like an hour later or whatever. And I finally got in. And so I was in this little mastermind group. The reason I wanted to be in there is because there were some other people in there. Like, the guy that's running the mastermind is probably doing 100, 150 million a year in sales. I'm not sure. He was at 100 then. I'm not sure if he's at 150 now, something like that. And but there were a number of other people in there that were doing 50 million in sales. And we did 10 million in sales last year in 2018. And I wanted to be around a couple of people that had built companies quickly that were doing 50 million in sales. And I knew a couple of them were in there. So I finally got in, and that was in March, I believe. And then I started going through some of their processes, some of their materials. And in April, I really realized that, okay, there's something wrong with the way I built my company. And this is a key, this was one of my key epiphanies for the year, okay? I had this realization. I went back and added up all the revenue that we'd ever done in the history, all the cash sales we'd ever had. And I looked at all the clients we'd ever had, right? So I divided it. I said total sale, total cash divided by a number of clients. And that basically gave me my lifetime value of clients, you know, to date for the business. And I realized that we were charging our clients on average about like $4,800. And so, you know, if you think about it, that's not a lot. And, you know, it's not enough. And so, you know, it started to really get me to think about lifetime value of the client. Like, how, like, what are the products and services that we are offering? Because I know how to get customers. I know how to get clients. I know how to sell. And I know I'll be able to get as many clients as I need. But what are they buying? What are we selling? And that really made me think about that in a pretty profound way, that calculation. And it sent me on this journey to try to sort of redesign the client experience to maximize lifetime value of the client. One of the things you got to remember too is, if you're going to charge somebody, if you're charging somebody $4,800 a year, and you're going to go from charging them $4,800 a year to charging them $250,000 a year, or $100,000 a year, or $30,000 a year, or whatever, I mean, you have to provide a whole different kind of value. And you can't charge somebody like 10 times more or 20 times more without like changing the paradigm completely. Like, you can't just do a little bit better. You have to do like something completely different. And so that sent me on a journey for the rest of the year to try to figure out, like, my, you know, I'm working with obviously tax and accounting firms. And so trying to figure out, okay, well, what kind of businesses are working with tax and accounting firms that, and in my particular niche, are, you know, doing big numbers, or doing 500 million a year in sales, or doing a billion a year in sales. And I found a couple, and I started to not necessarily like try to understand what problems are they solving and how could those problems be solved better. And that's what we spent really the rest of the year working on. And so that I've really figured out in April. And then in May, I actually got